Hello and welcome to java9s.com. I'm Srinivas. In this session, we're going to look at the Java control statements. We're going to look at the if-else switch, and in the loops, we'll be looking at the while, do while, for loop, and break, continue, and return statements. And also, finally, we'll be looking at the labeled break and labeled continue statements. Coming to the if condition, the syntax of this if condition is something like this, where you will be having a conditional statement which will be evaluated to be a true or is going to be false. If the conditional statement is going to be true, then all the statements that are there inside the if condition are going to get executed. And if there is an else statement that is present, then and the condition is going to be false, then all the statements inside the else block will get executed. So let us see this with an example here. In this main method, I have initialized the integer with x is equal to 4, and I have these if conditions checking if the value of x is greater than 5, and the next if condition, else if condition, is going to check for if value of x is greater than 3. And finally, I have an else block which states that if both the x values not greater than 5 and 3. So if I execute this straight away, it executes evaluates the second if condition stating that x is greater than 3. So I'm just going to run this example now. So it is evaluating to x is greater than 3. So this is an example of else if condition. Now let us look at the switch statement. With this switch statement, we can avoid a lot of nested if conditions. I can explain you with an example, something like this. Let us say we are asked to develop a program where when a user enters a number, by looking at the number, it has to print the month. So first, let us see how the syntax is going to be. For the switch statement, the expression should evaluate to byte, short, or integer type. And the case will have the byte or short or int numbers out here. So whenever a number 5 is going to come, the switch statement always checks for the case 5 and starts executing all the statements inside that case. We'll directly see this with an example. So you can let us see this with here. I have a switch statement here, switch block. First, in this place, I'm getting the input from the user about the number to be entered, like enter the month number. And I, because the input is going to be coming as a string, I'm changing it to a primitive data type where I'm just passing with an integer.parse int to and this will give me a primitive integer type, and I'm just telling it to switch to choose a block with this month number, and immediately it checks whatever the case is going to get matched, it will execute that particular case, and if nothing is going to get matched, then the default block is going to get executed. So I'll just run this example first. So it'll ask to enter the month, and if I'm entering 2, it'll print the month as February and the shortest month of the year. So this is how the cases will get chosen based on the number that is coming to the switch statement. The advantage with the switch statement is that if your expression can get evaluated to an integer type or shorter byte, then you can avoid a lot of if and else if statements, so which will save a lot of processing to be done. Please remember that if you don't put a break at the end of each case, then there's a good chance that the next case will also get executed automatically. Say for example, I'm just removing the break or just commenting it here. Now, if I start executing it and if the case 1 is going to get evaluated, automatically the case will also get, printed out here. So I'm just entering it 1 here. You can see that February will also get printed out here. So I have January, the case one is getting printed, and also the case two is also getting printed here. So by giving a break statement, you are avoiding the execution to fall to the next case also. And the other thing you have to remember is that the default block is always optional, and it need not be always at the end of the switch block. So now I'll just execute this program to touch the default statement. I'm just going to enter some other number which does not evaluate to any case, that is 23, and you can see that my default block is getting executed here. So this is all about the switch statement. Now let us look at the loops. The first kind of loop statement is while loop. If you see the syntax of this, while will have a conditional statement which has to get true to execute all the statements inside the block. This loop will keep getting executed until the while condition becomes false. So let us see this with an example. So here we have the while demo. I've just used a counter here where I'm just initializing an integer x is equal to 0 and checking if x is less than 0, then 0, then printing the value of x, and then incrementing the value of x by 1. So I'm just incrementing it. So in this we'll be printing the values from 0 to 19, and when the value of x reaches to 20, this statement stands false because x is now equal to 20. So automatically it quits the loop and immediately starts executing the next statement, that is after the loop. So I'm just going to execute this statement. So you can see that all the numbers from 0 to 19 are getting printed, and it is also printing the end of the loop after coming out of the loop. Please remember that if you don't take care of making this condition false, then the while loop is going to end up as an infinite loop. Say for example, if I stop incrementing this value of x, then this value of x is always going to stay lower than 20. So this becomes an infinite loop and keeps on getting executed. So you can see that the loop never ends and keeps going on. So this is a problem if you don't try to make the condition as false. So I'm just working it. This is all about while. And coming to the next loop type is an do while. The difference between while and do while is that do while can be used in certain conditions, like you want to execute the set of statements at least once without checking the condition, and once the statements are run, then after that you will be looking for the conditional statement. Here you can see that first the statements will get executed and then the condition will be checked, and if the condition is false, then the while is going to get quit. So let us take an example here. I'm just let us say that you are looking the user to enter certain commands, and if the user enters a wrong command, then you should prompt him to enter the command again. So here we can use the do while condition, where I'm just declaring a string command here, and I have also declared a boolean variable known as is wrong command. So if the command is wrong, I'm going to say it as a true, and if command is right, I'm going to say it as false. So I'm just getting the input from the user in this do while block. I'm getting it from J option pane and checking if the command is equal to hello. If it is yes, then I'm printing this hello command is right, and I'm saying that is wrong command is false. So if he enters hello, then automatically this statement is evaluating to false, and the do while will end executing the statements and comes out of it. If the user enters the wrong command, then this statement will get executed and the is wrong command will be set to true, and the loop will again get executed and it'll ask the user to enter the command again. Now let us execute this program to see how it works. For the first time, it'll ask me to enter the command. I'm just entering as test instead of hello. So it'll ask me to enter the command again because is wrong command is getting true, and this while will again put me back into the loop. So until I enter hello, it'll put me inside the loop. So this is the advantage of the do while, where it executes the statements at least once without checking, you know, for the condition. Then please remember that another point I would like to tell you is that if whatever the variables you are initializing them in this block will not be accessible in this condition. So if you want to check for any variables in the conditional statement, then please declare them outside this block so that you'll be able to access them here. Then next we'll be looking at the for loop. This is mostly used for the iteration with using the counters. So this has got three parts. The first part is the initialization part, where you can initialize or declare certain variables and initialize them with some values. And the second part is the condition, where only when this condition is true, the control comes inside the for loop. And the third part is the increment or decrement part, where you can increment the values you have initialized or some other things. So please remember that this initialization and this incrementing or decrement part are optional, and the condition is always mandatory part. And if this is true, the control will come inside the for loop. So we'll look at this.